Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasajja. Now, as the country was opening up after the prolonged lockdown to combat the effects of COVID-19, one of the things that the country experienced were traffic jams that were a nightmare, even in the absence of public transport. Today, to discuss this issue that has become a nightmare, is the Minister for Works and Transport, General Katumba Wamala. General, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
General, before we go into the discussion of traffic jams and roads, one or your viewer out there would like to know, how has life been like transiting from a career army man to civil service, which is by and large political?
Thank you very much. Of course, it has not been easy. But the good thing is that when you're in the military, as you grow up in the military, every level you reach, you go through a training. And every training prepares you for the next one. At the level at which I was, like the CDF, I'd already been prepared for strategic leadership. So while it's a challenge moving to the civilian life, it's not insurmountable. The only challenge is that in the military, things are kind of well streamlined, you know. They're structured. They follow order. It's this, you deliver this within this time frame, and then it will be done. In the civil service, things are not the same. There's a lot, it calls for a lot of patience, because the way things are done in the civil service is not the same way it's done in the military. But it has been a learning curve. I've been able to learn how to handle, the personnel in the civil service, how to deal with the procedures in the civil service, which are quite different from the military. So it has been a learning curve, and I'm still learning. I'm not yet. I can't say I've learned it all.
General, you were an admired army officer, but in the civilian world, there is fear that in Uganda, there is that the army is quickly taking over all sectors of the civilian life, and from the police to now works, all government departments and agencies are now being filled by the army. There is fear that is the country being militarized?
No. I think it's also a very good thing for this country, because looking at what the military was before and looking at what the military is now, that it can produce people who can transition from a uniform to civilian life and be able to deliver, I think that's a plus to the nation, that the country has been able to produce an army which can be able to, you know, serve both in the uniform and also out of uniform. But it's not that the army is taking over everything. No, I think, and it is. It's in, even in many countries, many people have that kind of feel that maybe the army, when somebody has a military background, there is some unique aspects it brings on the table. For example, in the U.S., until just recently, it was always first, if somebody, even a president, they'd ask, "Did you serve in Vietnam?" If you didn't serve in Vietnam, that already would throw off some marks of you. So I think it's good even in this country to see that the military can be able to produce people and produce nationals who can serve well in both aspects.
But General, going to the discussion, to main discussion, last month when you were launching the Road Safety Amendment Act 2020, you said the law will help reduce chaos but also hold reckless road users culpable for their acts and misbehavior. What does this mean?
Well, there have been a number of amendments which came into being because of the amendments in the law. The act as it was made in 1998 had now become kind of washed down because a lot of things have changed. What the act now gives the powers, the minister, more authority, more powers, especially to organize the transport industry. For example, in the amendment, Section 39, which was an amendment of Section 71 in the old law, it gives empowers the minister to organize the transport system in the country, which was not so before. If you don't mind, I could even read that particular section, because I think it's important that the public understands where even my authority now comes to try and reorganize the tax industry. It says in part, Section 71 of the Principal Act is amended by inserting immediately after subsection 1 the following. 1A, the minister may, in organizing public transport under subsection 1, require public transport providers to form companies, registered associations, partnerships, cooperatives, or saving and credit cooperative societies in a manner prescribed by regulation in order to qualify for license under this act. So you can see that is something which the minister did not have before, right? And B, it says the minister may by regulation require public transport providers to make special provisions for persons with a disability. For example, if somebody now wants to bring in a transport system like the bus system, your buses must be able to accommodate persons with disability, and it will be demanded and requirement. So these are some of the new things which the Act brings on to.
General, this mandate given to the minister to regulate public transport, there is suspicion that it is going to edge out taxis and buses. And yet, when, for example, you observe, yes, previously Kampala had traffic jams, but when the president opened up, he first released private vehicles, but the traffic jam that was seen had never been seen on these roads, and yet there are no taxis and borders.
Well, first of all, let me make this clear. There is no intention of government to edge out the tax operators. That's not true. What we are saying is that this industry needs to be organized better than what it is now. It is so informal that you may not even be able to trace who owns which taxi, who is the driver of which taxi. I think you have heard of instances where an accident happens and you say, who's the driver? Chivalua. So the Chivalua man, you can't trace him. You have heard of instances where people have been mugged in taxis in the evenings and they can't trace who owns that taxi. Now, this is part of what we are doing. What we are doing, including the registrations by Kampala State Council and ourselves, is to put sanity in the industry. I'll tell you that, for example, the people who are like managing, quote-unquote, this industry, many of them are not tax owners, they're not drivers, they're not conductors. But they manage the industry. They don't even invest any coin on a tire, on fuel, on salary of the drivers, but they manage the industry. Well, that's not a problem. We need to make them better organized so that they don't cause a lot of problems in the industry. So there is no plan for us to send the taxis away. But if it so happens that there is growth, because what we want them to grow out of taxi into buses so that we can reduce on the number of vehicles on the road. We want to help them get better organized, manage their funds better, and build that industry from a taxi now to a bus by forming those cooperative societies or those associations. And they can do it if they manage their funds better. They can do it.
General, well, yes, I agree, but you will also agree with me that any sort of change would affect some people. One of the challenges in this country is youth unemployment. And this particular sector, for example, the president last time said taxi touts should not continue with their work. And that's a huge number of people that have been aged out. Mm. Border boarders are still lying idle at work, and probably they could have gotten a loan here or there to start life. Mm. As government that is also concerned about the well-being of all Ugandans, have you taken this into account, that these changes are going to affect some people and we are planning on dealing with them like this?
Yes, but you see also, let's first observe this. Some of these measures have been forced on us because of the condition, the present situation. When you talk about borders, it's because of the COVID situation, which is highly understandable. And I would want every Ugandan who has a thinking about the future of this country and the lives of Ugandans to understand that these measures are not intended to cause people, to throw people out of business. It is because of the situation. So, for example, even yesterday, we spent practically the whole day, myself, Minister of Security, KCCA, talking with the borders to try to see how, for example, can they get back in business without compromising the health situation. So some of these measures are not permanent measures. They will be fixed according to how the COVID situation behaves. And many of these are not, it's not about the comfort of people. It's about enabling people to stay alive. And that's the most important, that people stay alive. Even if you're out of business now and you stay alive, at least you'll be able to recover. Yes, later on when you can go back to work. So it's what we are trying to avoid, and what the government's efforts are to avoid the body bags, to avoid the coffins, as we have seen in many countries. And that is critical.
Geno, you said you want these taxis and border people to register and organize themselves into circles,
yes.
Like formal organizations, and
yes.
Then they grow into buses.
Yes.
Is this to say that government is now conceding that it cannot manage public transport and they want to organize private transport to fully take it over? Or should we still have hope that one day the government of Uganda will come back into the management of public transport?
Yes. Now, again, we go back to your question. The first one you said, all these people, if they go out of business, what happens? Because of the employment. If tomorrow government took over all the transport system in the country, what would happen to all these people who are within the taxi industry? So instead of edging them out to create another problem, it's better we can, for now, organize them. And government now is looking more at PPP arrangements, public-private partnership, as opposed to government running business. Government, most cases, are not very good business managers. It would be much better if we promote the private sector growth. That's what would make life easier. Yes, government can invest in heavy transport systems like a light railway, which of course the private sector would find a challenge investing in. So government could invest in such things. But for this kind of transport system like the buses, these ones, the private sector surely can't be able to do that. And I think like when you see the bus industry, those ones which are going up country, I think the private sector has managed. Of course, they have challenges which government should help them to overcome, like high interest on the loans which they get to buy the vehicles. That's where government could come in to see how to help them get affordable funding for them to invest.
General, before we leave this issue, in the new regulations, motor vehicles are required to go through mandatory motor vehicle inspection.
Yes.
But you remember, I think in 2017, the company that was contracted to do this work, SGS, had questions on the way the irregularities in the way the contract was awarded. And there is a report in Parliament to this effect that has never been put to rest. Has this issue been resolved?
Yes, the issue has been resolved because Parliament when Parliament intervened in 2017 and the contract was stopped, there were two reports. There was a report of the majority of the members of the Infrastructure Committee, which recommended renegotiation of the contract. And then there was a minority report, which recommended for total cancellation of the contract. Now, we went by, we got the instruction from Parliament to pursue what the majority report said. So the ministry, under guidance of the Attorney General, started on the renegotiation of the contract. And this has been done. And this has been, we have even now come up with an addendum to the original contract. And I think one of the new changes is that originally this was a build, operate and own. That's how the contract was. But now we have changed it to build, operate and transfer. So at the end of the term, when the SGS...
Maybe you could help us understand the difference. Build, okay. Operate and own, build, operate and transfer.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
What is the difference?
When the build, own and operate, the build, operate and own, that would mean that the infrastructure belongs to the investor. Because this is a foreign direct investment, which the infrastructure, all these test stations, the money, the investment is not by government. Is by the company, SGS. So the BOO would mean that even after recouping their money, possibly they could contract that to somebody else, right? So it would not be a government asset. But the build, operate and transfer means that once they recoup their money, then the whole infrastructure belongs to government.
We revert to government.
So it becomes a government property. And that's the beauty of the changes. The others were, of course, another one was, of course, about rates, where the for example, the rate for checking the border was higher than checking the bus. All those have been addressed, and in the new addendum, the rates have been agreed on, and we think they are really affordable. I think there was also a misunderstanding where, in the first place, how this thing came to be stopped was that people thought there was a time limit for checking the vehicle for roadworthiness. No, it's not there. There will be no time limit. You yourself, just like the way you check your life every year, hope that people go through health checks every year, so does your vehicle. Your vehicle also needs a health check every year. And more so like vehicles which carry large capacity of people like buses, taxis, surely we need to know whether that vehicle is roadworthy or not.
But Geno, what other key highlights are in the law that your viewer out there would like to take cognizant of?
Yes, there's been, among the others, is about the driving permit. And there's been something, the new inject is about the demerit points on driving permits because of people have been misbehaving on our roads and they get away with it. Now, the new act, the amended act, gives me the powers to make regulations which would cause you, your driving permit, to lose points, to be demerited if you are a perpetual road offender on the roads. So it would mean that after some time, your driving permit will not be valid for use on the road, because every time you cause an accident, then your points are reduced. The other one is about the reckless driving and you cause death. And it's reckless driving, and it is defined, also reckless driving is defined. So if you cause reckless driving, if you do reckless driving and you cause death, unnecessarily, the penalty is very high. It's about 10 years without even having
At some point, you in the public, in a public address, you said we are going to transfer, to move from driving permits to driving licenses.
Yes.
Probably someone would like to understand what's the difference between a driving permit and a driving license.
A driving license gives you authority to handle a vehicle beyond the borders. So you can drive in Rwanda, you can drive in within the region when you have a driving license, as opposed to a driving permit. And that's the international standard now.
So we are now moving to acquiring driving licenses.
Yes.
One of the issues in your concession with government concessions with FACE Technologies, which is charged with issuing driving permits, you had agreed that the company will build capacity for Ugandans to handle this kind of system. How far has FACE Technologies and government gone in building this capacity?
Oh, I think the best would be for you to visit the facility and you see how many Ugandans run the facility. 95%, if not 98%, of the people who are running the show in the FACE Technology are Ugandans. It's only a few experts who are South Africans, and that's because the software is still there, is still the South African software, because it belongs to FACE Technology. They have patent for it. Otherwise, 98% of all the people who run the show in the issuing of the driving licenses are Ugandans.
So when should we expect 100%?
We'll get there. We'll get there because, as you possibly know, we are in a transition stage where Uganda Security Printing Company will be taking over from FACE Technology. We are moving towards that. And so Uganda Security Printing Company is a Ugandan company. So it will be able to.
But you are aware that during this period, the queues at FACE Technologies are heartbreaking.
Yes.
So now the fear is that probably if FACE Technology is in the transition and we are having these long queues with 90% of Ugandans handling the system, what will happen if we have a 100% transfer?
No, I think the queues are not because Ugandans are running the show. The queues were because of the. We had when there was a lockdown, we locked down also FACE Technology. So there was a backlog of people who wanted to renew their driving permits, licenses, and those who want to acquire new ones. And that explains the queues. But we have now made it very clear, for those who are acquiring new driving licenses, they should wait for July. Those who are renewing, this is the period, up to end of June, we shall only be renewing the old ones. Yeah, and that will get out the queue. Yeah, there was excitement when we opened, just like what you saw when we opened the private transport in the city and everybody hit the road. Well, there was an argument that when we said there should be only, is it three people per vehicle? That maybe some families have more than five vehicles. So each one brought out a vehicle. That's, you can see that even that one now is subsiding. I think there was an excitement when we opened. People had not been behind the steering wheel for some time.
People went on road tests
to see whether their vehicles are still functional, whether it still has the techniques of maneuvering in the city. But that's easing now. And it's easing because also the public transport is back on road. So that will ease more.
Geno, probably you should tell us a bit more in detail how the demerits point system will work.
That one will come in detail once we make the regulations. Once we make the regulations, because the Act now empowers me to make regulations. So we are going to do that. We are going to make the regulations, then we communicate those regulations.
So as Ugandans wait for the regulations, one would wonder whether the new law is also going to handle the issue of the right of way. You know, it has been very controversial. It even reached Parliament that it seems like every Tom, Dick and Harry in this country now has a right of way. Mm-hmm. Are you handling this and how?
Yeah, and that's part of the indiscipline. And when you talk about traffic jams on our roads, part of it is that is caused by indiscipline. Because everybody wants to be in a hurry. Sometimes to get nowhere. You wonder even people are going back home. What's the hurry for? Why do you have to go, you know, zigzagging? When the policeman, sometimes I feel sorry for those traffic officers, when they're trying to manage and organize the traffic flow, and somebody, because he has an SUV or this VX or 8, he puts the alarm and he wants to find that he has the right of way. Now, this law will partially address that. And good enough now, we know, by the time we go into all the details of this, even the security camera systems would have worked. So you may jump the queue, you may do that, and you think you're smarter, but then once the camera captures you, I don't need to go tracking you because I know your vehicle number and I know who owns that vehicle number. Then me, I'll enter into the system how to demerit your driving permit.
General, the law sounds very comprehensive, but Ugandans are good at circumventing procedures. And one of the challenges that has been highlighted is that whereas we have very good laws in this country,
is the enforcement
is a challenge. Mm. How are you, as a minister that everyone trusts, are you ready to ensure that these good laws are implemented?
Well, I think it takes time for cultures and behaviors to change. First of all, we are going to educate people about this law. We have 6 months. I've given my director of transport and the commissioner responsible for transport and road safety 6 months to educate people about the law. And so we hope that through that education, we shall be able to achieve some change behavior, that people will come to understand that there is a law which needs to be respected. But of course, also we depend a lot on the police to enforce the law. So working in partnership, we think we should be able to have a change, behavior change by our people. But, you know, sometimes it's also defeats the purpose. Why do you want to have a policeman breathing behind your back for you to respect the law? That's what we need to change as Ugandans. Why should I have a policeman? And because they say, simulaba o policeman, simulaba. Why do you need to have a policeman behind you all the time? Because you are like being policed. You can police yourself.
Yourself.
Yes.
With that, General, let's go for a very short break. You are still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasajja. And today we are talking to the Minister for Works and Transport, General Katumba Wamala. General, when we broke off, we were still trying to examine how best we can decongest the city. One of the things that has come to light during these COVID times is that there is so much potential in the use of water transport. How far have you gone with ensuring that the country develops water transport, especially in terms of decongesting cargo trucks?
Yeah, thank you very much. Very good question. Everything happens, whatever situation comes gives you some lessons. And I think one of the jacks and the eye-openers which COVID has brought us is about the importance of rail and water transport. And this is something which even the president has been repeatedly talking about. Of course, as you remember, we had the setback when we concessioned the URC to RVR and they ran down most of our assets. Now we got back URC and now we are trying to revamp most of the assets and reintroduce some of these assets on the routes. One of those which we are doing is the promotion of water transport, and we are already in the final stages of rehabilitating one of our assets, Pamba. Pamba is already got a contractor, Mango Tree, who are doing the rehabilitation. Kawa has been on service and is off the dock, to be off the dock this week. And so these two assets, and also partnering with the Kenya and Tanzania, we have been able to reopen those routes. I can tell you that with Kawa getting back on the water, we should be able to haul about 1.8 million liters of fuel every month. And that takes up off the road about 88 trucks off the road if we do that. Already, we have on two occasions, we have hauled more than 1.6 million liters. So it's very, very important that the water transport gets refurbished, gets back as a contributor to the national economy and transport system.
General, don't you think that the construction of the standard gauge railway is long overdue? Mm-hmm. And this was promised in the NRM manifesto.
Yes. I quite agree. Yes, it's the expectations of people are expecting the standard gauge level today, tomorrow. Just a brief is that the standard gauge railway was conceived as a regional project. It's not purely just a Ugandan project. It's a regional project. Because what was looked at and what was being aimed at is to have a seamless system all the way from Mombasa through to Kampala, through to Kigali and South Sudan. Of course, the progress in Kenya has progressed. But even as I speak now, it's up to Naivasha. It has not yet reached Kisumu. And from Kisumu, that's when it was supposed to connect to Malaba. So there is a need for us to have a very good coordination mechanism that we don't construct something which will be hanging before it connects, right? So it's a timing factor that we time as Kenya progresses, we start ours, so that as soon as the Kenya reaches where we are supposed to connect, the system is seamless. So the standard gauge railway, is it still a focused project? Yes, it's still among the strategic projects which we will implement. The question is not whether, it's just when, and we shall be able to implement it.
You highlight the question of when.
Yeah.
That is when they want to. Because one of the feelings has been that probably the project has been delayed by government bureaucracy and then power play within government agencies.
No.
And then the feeling that the funders, China, feels that there is the new route that was proposed does not give value for money.
No. That's not true, because you see, when you look at the trade component within the region, if you look at the volume of trade, 90% of the goods which come in through Mombasa are destined for the interior, Uganda, Rwanda, Congo, South Sudan. So there's no way that the route will not be economically viable. It's not there. It can only be an economically viable if it ends in Kenya, because that would mean that they are holding only about 10% or 15% of the cargo. But if you are going to hold all the cargo which comes into the interior, then there's no way the route cannot be viable economically. So that's not the issue. The issue is really harmonization of action between us and Kenya, and also the funding mechanisms which will be discussed. There has been no infighting within government departments about the project. No, right from NDP, the National Development Plan, to the manifesto, to the strategic directives, to the ministry implementation plan and strategic plan. The standard gauge is a focus project.
Jen, I would go back to when will harmonized action take place between Uganda and Kenya so that work start to give a glimpse of hope?
That's work in progress. There are a number of things which are also happening. For example, we are doing training of people who will be involved in the construction, training of people who will run the system, because it would not make sense for us to start the construction and then we have 80% of the workforce coming in from China. So we have to train our own people, and that we are doing. I can tell you that in liaison with the army, we have even now a crop of engineers and a crop of people who can lay the line and weld the line. So we have to develop the manpower, we have to develop the technical know-how, because would you love to have your system run by Chinese? We need to acquire the right of way for the land. Unlike a road project with a railway, you can't say we do 5 kilometers, jump and go and do another 5 kilometers ahead because we have not acquired that piece of land. No, once you start the construction, it's continuous, because it's a welded system which must be continuous. So all these are happening now, but you may not see that. But these are all preparatory actions which are happening.
General, dragging you back a bit to the law, you said that you're going to roll out a 6-month sensitization program for people to understand the law.
Yes.
But the fear is that probably in most cases these kinds of programs are elitist. Mm. Are you going to bring down this sensitization to the wananchi?
Okay. You see, what the beauty in this country now, and thanks to the NRM government, is that the airwaves are spread everywhere. Practically everybody now can access a radio. You know, sometimes you go even in the village and you find somebody's in the garden, but his car radio is there beside him. So the reach out is easy, and we are going to take advantage of the media, like your facilities for the elites people. Yes, they'll be able to watch. For those who cannot watch, they can listen. So we shall be able to use all the media platforms which we have to be able to disseminate the information.
General, to paraphrase from the amendment, all drivers will also be required to complete all vehicle transfers to avoid future complications in case vehicles they sold are involved in criminal incidents.
Yes.
Expound on this point.
What was happening now is you find Katumba sold to your vehicle 4 or 5 years ago, but I never took trouble to transfer this vehicle. Or you the one, the buyer, try to make effort to transfer the vehicle, but maybe I just disappear. Now, when that vehicle is found in a criminal act, the question is, who is the owner? You get my point? So if for example, that vehicle is still in my names, and I sold it to you 5 years ago, and found at a criminal site, they'll ask, they'll be looking out for Katumba, because that vehicle is still being my names. Now, we are saying, originally it was the responsibility of the buyer to ensure that it gets the transfer. Now, both of you are equally responsible to ensure that the vehicle is transferred from you, who has sold, to the buyer. I can tell you that in this exercise which we are conducting, the registration of the taxis, this has been one of the biggest challenges. People have vehicles which they bought 10 years ago, 5 years. They don't know who, they can't remember who sold the vehicle.
They can't trace who sold the vehicle.
So we are kind of even thinking with URIA how we can have a cut-off point and we start afresh. So these are the issues which are going to be chewed by the new law.
Government, General, in the new law, the government will have power to revoke the license of any medical facilities that will refuse to provide medical treatment to accident victims without proving their financial ability, the victims. Government is slowing down. It hasn't fast tracked the National Insurance Service Scheme as everyone would have wished. Do you think putting this kind of provision in the law is fair without a national insurance cover for everyone, but then hold the medical facilities at ransom?
Well, there is the matter of the national insurance is still a matter of debate, which will be in Parliament. Parliament will debate it and possibly be able to come out with the directives. But this is about you having a human heart. He has an accident victim who has been brought into your facility. Government, even if you buy the drugs yourselves, the drugs are not taxed. You buy the drugs tax-free. Yeah? Government has even made it conducive for you to operate. And the person's brought into your facility, bleeding. And surely you can stop this bleeding and save life. Does it humanly make sense for you to send that person away? There is the, apart from the money, there is the human part of it. And I think it's also demanded of the doctors to save lives. I think so. I don't know. But I think they're supposed to do that. So the first thing is, can you stop the bleeding? Can you be able to stabilize? We are not saying give him full treatment. No, save his life so that he can be evacuated to a better hospital.
General, granted, but I've been irresponsible and I've been involved in an accident while drunk driving.
Now, don't judge. First save the life. Then we will go back to see how did you get into this situation. The first thing is save that life.
But General, as we are coming to the end of this show, one of the entities, some of the entities you superintend works in Uganda is very slow, and at times it costs government money. There is a time you were UNRWA was in parliament, and they were saying government is being charged for delayed works on the new expressway on Queensway. How are you dealing with this? The same case is at the upgrade and expansion of Entebbe International Airport.
Okay. Well, I think partially the problem was that before many of the projects were initiated or started before we had got money to do the land acquisition, which is mainly, you know, in common terms called counterpart funding. Even when you get a loan, that loan does not involve the component of you paying for the project affected persons. That's a responsibility of government. But in some cases, these projects were initiated without the government guaranteeing that there is money to pay the project affected persons. That was one. The other reason, which was something which usually brought in the delay, was that you'd find that even where government has money, acquiring the land becomes a nightmare because of the land law in this country, that the land belongs to the people. So I can refuse. That's the provision that until I'm compensated adequately, I may not allow the project to proceed. So all these are impediments. But now on the first one, it has now been passed by the Committee on National Economy, and they have made it mandatory. There's no project where government will put signature to the dotted line without ensuring that there is money for counterpart funding. That's now a requirement. And so that will not happen again. Before, we used to have, for example, money for land compensation tied to a project. For example, if the project was 150 million, and land compensation is 50 million, it would be tied to this particular project. Yeah? So you'd find, for example, project X is delayed for some other reason, but because the money is tied there, you cannot move this money to project Y to do the land compensation, which would be moving. Now, we have overcome that. Minister of Finance has agreed to put all the money for land acquisition in a pool, in one account. So it does, whichever project is moving, you pay the people. And so that will not cause a delay. The only area now which has not been resolved is the accessibility, where an individual Ugandan says, until you adequately compensate me, I don't give way. Because many times, even where a government, chief government valuer has valued the land, people have said, no, that valuation, I don't believe in that valuation. And then they have stopped the project progress. So, and that was the reason why there was that provision when we, at one time, government tried to say, let's have some flexibility. If it's a government project on the land law, if it's a government project, allow the project to proceed. If, for example, the chief government valuer has said, your piece of land, I've valued it at 50 million shillings, but for you, you want it at 80 million. Allow the project to proceed. The government puts the 50 million in the court. Yeah? And you appeal to the court. You go to the court and make an appeal. If the court pronounces itself that actually you are right, your piece of land is 80 million, then government will add the 30 million. Right? And then you'll get your 80 million. If the court, for example, says, no, it is even more than 80 million, it's 90 million, government then would add the 40 million on the 50 which they have already deposited in the bank. That way we would be able to move our projects faster.
General, the monster called unfavorable negotiation of loans in Uganda. I'll give you an example. Uganda Civil Aviation Authority is decrying that terms of the loan they negotiated with Exim Bank for the upgrade and expansion of Entebbe International Airport were unfavorable. What strategy, as the minister, do you have to deal with this?
Yeah, good question, but negotiations, loan negotiations, are not a matter of the ministry. This is between, it goes back to Minister of Finance and Attorney General. And these are the two bodies, which, because they know about the terms in the financing, the financing terms, and then the Attorney General checks out the law, whether it's favorable to the government or it's favorable to the contractor. So these are the two bodies which do the negotiations of those loans.
General, your commitment to integrity is undisputed, but corruption in agencies, mostly that you superintend over, the president has publicly decried. What's your strategy?
Well, I think that's corruption is a monster which is hanging over the Uganda. It's not only within my ministry. I can't totally say there's no corruption, but what we need, I think this is something all Ugandans, all of us, should have a responsibility to fight, because I will not know whether my engineer X has been corrupted until I can't sit here and know whether he has been, an engineer who's supervising a project in Kayunga, for example, has been corrupted, until somebody blows the whistle. So I think we all need to be responsible, because also that corruption is there is a willing giver
and a willing taker.
So we should be able to break that kind of way of life where people think it's the norm. So if we are able to break the norm, which people call the normal, and we make it an abnormal, that if somebody is asking for a bribe for you, because you know, once you accept today, that means even tomorrow and the next day. So it becomes endless. So if all of us become responsible and all of us say no to corruption, because it starts with you. You know, when you talk about corruption in this country, look at it from even the family. It's time for exams. You as a parent, you are buying test papers for your child. Eh? We what do they call it? A sasi. you buy a masasi.
Yeah, kasasi.
It's a kasasi for your son. Now, if that son tomorrow is the engineer, what would happen? Even in primary schools, I hear that when children are going to be elected prefects, children go to their parents and say, "Tata, Daddy, I need some money to buy sweets to give to, so that they can vote for me." So this is where corruption starts, because that is already, you are training, you know, you are corrupting the mind, and you have started training corruption right from childhood. So we need to fight this animal together.
General, buildings are collapsing and they are killing Ugandans. Mm. Your inspecting engineers seem to be sleeping on the job.
No and yes. One, that the responsibility of the supervising buildings, according to the Act of 2013, it is invested in the local authorities. All local authorities are supposed to supervise the construction of these buildings, right? And now, if you don't have the capacity as a local authority, for example, a municipal council, for example, a district committee, if you don't have the capacity to do that, you ask the National Building Review Board to help you with that capacity. Now, the National Building Review Board supervises the local authorities. to ensure that what they are doing is right. If the local authorities fail to supervise, for example, I'll give you the case of the building which collapsed in Kabaragala. That is, should be the responsibility of KCCA to say yes, these plans are right, to say that the man is the team which is constructing that building has all the qualifications which are required to be on site, right? And then the National Building Review Board supervises KCCA to see whether KCCA has been able to give the right directives and right supervision to the builder.
General, with that, we cannot continue this conversation. Thank you for making time to the show. You've been watching The Checkpoint, and we've been hosting General Katumba Amala, the Minister for Works and Transport. Be sure to catch us tomorrow, same time. Good night.